Good evening, everyone. My name is Stephen, and I'm a member of Hampshire Scouts. Now, in the Scouts, we love an adventure, and tonight we're going to be hearing a tale of one adventure of epic proportions. As part of our partnership between the Scouts and the Army, we're going to hear from Lieutenant Colonel Rich Hall, who was part of the Army Force Atlantic team as they took on the Talisker Whiskey Atlantic Challenge. So we're going to find out about them as we tell them their story. Now, you'll be able to ask questions throughout using the Q&A box, and we'll ask them all to the team at the very end. So, Rich, over to you.
Thank you very much. I'm delighted to be here, and thank you to everyone in the Scouts Association, Hampshire Scouts in particular, for letting us come to talk to you a little bit about what we did, why we did it, and who we were, and what it felt like to row 3,000 miles across the North Atlantic Ocean. I'm joined tonight by Captain Chris Haynes, who is even older than me, and he's struggling a little bit with technology, so he's trying to log in at the minute, so we may hear from him later. But either way, we've both got a couple of stories to tell about what it was like to do what we did. But before I get into the meat of the presentation, I just wanted to explain a little bit about the fact that whilst we're in the Atlantic is an extraordinary event, the four of us that did it are pretty unremarkable people, which is sometimes difficult to get across when you are in an organisation like the Army, because people see the Army as an adventurous, outgoing sort of organisation that attracts people with this sense of adventure that perhaps can do superhuman things. And actually, it's not quite like that. It's an organisation like any other that's founded on teamwork and loyalty and trust and a sense of unity and pride in what we do. And I think you'd find that in many, many walks of life. So part of this is about trying to convince people that whilst it seems like quite a daunting task, I think doing something like around the Atlantic is probably within every single one of us, whether you're an 18-year-old young private soldier or whether you're getting towards the end of your working life like me, and everyone in between, whether you're soldier, civilian or whatever. So to try and demystify the Army a little bit, I choose to show you a picture from my childhood, which perhaps reinforces a bit of a stereotype about people that join the Army always wanted to be in the Army. But whilst this is a picture from my childhood, it isn't actually me, that's my brother. And this was my mum and dad making fancy dress costumes to enter into a village fancy dress competition. My costume was slightly different. My mum made that, my dad made my brother's costume, and we won first and second place, very proud moment. But I put that up to show that I really wasn't interested in the Army, and I had joined Cubs, I've been in Scouts, but that sort of uniform service didn't really come to me at all until quite late on. Actually, at the point where I'd failed university and couldn't decide what to do with my life. But I do reflect on this picture and smile a little bit, and we see that my brother there in an Army costume eventually ended up joining the Royal Air Force. So we're almost wearing each other's uniforms in that particular picture from way back when. So as I said, I sort of catastrophically failed university and was wondering, you know, what I would do with life. And I sort of stumbled across the Army, really. Yep, from a bit of an Army family, but or a bit of a military family, but not really considered the Army before. And if I'm honest, I can't really put my finger on why I decided to join. Because for me, this picture was the sort of the stereotypical view of that I had of the Army at the time. It was perhaps full of posh people and toffs and people that came from perhaps very privileged backgrounds, had quite a lot of money, went to the right schools. But actually my experience of it having joined was completely different. I found it an organization that was based on camaraderie, that everyone worked for each other. And that cap badge that you can see in the top right hand corner of your picture has got a little motto underneath it called serve to lead. And that really epitomized everything that the Army taught us as young officers, that in order to lead people effectively, you have to serve them. You have to do their job and be able to do their job and understand them and devote yourself to them. And I really was sort of fell in love with that principle. And you got a couple of pictures from our final exercise at the end of the year. That was my birthday in Cyprus, and they made me a little tiny birthday cake out of Army rations. But again, I think it was those little moments that really told me that I was in the right place. I'd sort of found my home within the Army. And again, it was based around friendship and trust, which I think everyone craves. So my young military career was full of some fascinating stuff. I went to the jungle and became a jungle warfare instructor. I was trained on the Warrior armored fighting vehicle. I went to Kosovo for my first operational tour, which was great. And everyone wanted us to be there. The locals were really friendly. But my sort of second experience in Iraq was completely different. And I think this slide sort of summarizes the variety of things that you get involved in when you go abroad with the army. That picture top left was us doing a search operation with the Iraqi police. The top middle was the aftermath of a prison riot where we helped put down detainees that had escaped from their cells and put them back into the cells. We did river operations with the Royal Marines. We were under fire a lot, and that picture bottom left was one of my guys sort of sheltering as we did just on the floor of our ops room whilst the mortars came in. I think he's looking particularly glum because he was about to go on R&R that day and it got cancelled because of yet another mortar attack. I lost soldiers. Private Luke Simpson, the bottom middle there, was tragically killed by a roadside bomb. But we had some great moments training the Iraqi army. That bottom right picture was us teaching them how to do their own operations. And as much as it was a difficult tour, we did feel that we generated a really good bond with the Iraqi army and taught them some really valuable stuff to help them after we'd gone. So a fascinating tour that culminated for me in this, again, this band of brothers feeling that I'd got at Sandhurst. And that picture there, that's 110 of my company in the aftermath of a hostage rescue operation that we did with the American Special Forces. So this was boys' own stuff. Absolutely loved it. And really proud that I suppose the foundation for adventure and camaraderie and sort of seeking to do things out of the norm was definitely seeded in these early years. The most recent job I had in the Army was running what's called the Army Foundation College. And this is a totally unique organisation in the Army. It's full of teenagers, so 1,200 16 and 17 year old men and women that embark on their journey into the armed forces. And this was the reason, this job, this place, this unit that does amazing things in terms of education and leadership and sports and skills, is really what sowed the seed for rowing the Atlantic. Because we wanted to do something that championed what this place stood for, that it could showcase the remarkable journey that young men and women go on when they join the military, particularly the army. So we wanted to take a young junior soldier that had just finished training here and getting to do something remarkable and show people that with the right training, support and background and lighting their fires in terms of ambition, you can do some pretty amazing stuff. Now, this also came on the back of a recruiting campaign, which was it was popular, but it was also quite divisive. It certainly grabbed people's attentions and it really focused upon the millennial labeling of class clowns and phone zombies and that sort of thing. And really talking about how the army could see past all that and it saw potential in everyone, no matter what you thought of yourself and how remote that military service might seem to you, that there was a place in the army team for you. And we also had a documentary filmed. You probably won't have seen it because it's been on late at night on Channel 5. It's a little bit sweary, if I'm honest, because that's what soldiers do a little bit. But it was a really good series, second series that we've had filmed up at the college, which gave an insight into what life is like for the youngest recruits in NATO, in the world, essentially. So, as I mentioned, having a junior soldier as part of a team that was going to row across the Atlantic, the first British Army team to have gone across, officially branded as the Army, was a really, really important thing to do. So we ran a selection procedure. We asked for volunteers, about 100 of them, put their hand up and said, yep, I want to go for it. And we whittled it down through a pretty intensive selection procedure, down to the final few. And really, the overall choice came down to personality. Because they're all strong, they're all fit, but you can see that little boat on the screen, we thought it was going to take about 40 days to row across the Atlantic in very cramped conditions. So we absolutely had to have someone in our team, in our boat, as part of this voyage, that was the right fit and the right person to I think showcase what we were trying to do. As for the rest of us, you've got Alex on the left-hand side of that left-hand photo. a young captain in the cavalry, very strong, very well educated, deep thinker, and he was the sort of analytical brains behind the operation. Young Kian, as I've mentioned, 18-year-old soldier from Lancashire, had never even heard of rowing the Atlantic before he joined up at 16. And there he was with an aspiration to become a world record holder at 18. More of that in a moment. Myself, 23 years in the military now, I've got the rank of Lieutenant Colonel. I've been abroad quite a bit. I'm an infantry officer, so I suppose I've always backed myself in terms of physical challenges, but I'd never actually taken on anything that you'd class as adventurous. It was always sort of organised activity, mostly based around sport rather than these sort of expeditionary type things. And then the moody looking one, Chris Hames, on the right hand side of that left hand picture. Chris, year older than me, although I'll reinforce that fact at every opportunity. He's the oldest member of the team. Actually had his birthday out in the Atlantic. He won't remember it because I think dementia had certainly kicked in by then. Me and Chris formed a very close bond, I think, because of our age and our experiences. We've been away a lot on tour, and I think seen a bit and done a bit. So we certainly saw ourselves as helping the other two younger members through. A very interesting dynamic. You know, me as the boss of a 2,000 strong organisation, and young Kian there is the most junior member of that. And we ended up sharing a cabin and our most intimate moments together. I have my claim to fame is I've shared a 1 meter cubed bedroom with a teenager for the best part of 6 weeks and lived to tell the tale. And more importantly, Kian's lived to tell the tale as well. So there we go. So the route, we rode from the Canary Islands, so La Gomera, just near Tenerife, 3,000 miles across to Antigua in the Caribbean. So this was what's called the Talisker Whiskey Atlantic Challenge, an international rowing race. 35 teams entered it this year, but it is, for all intents and purposes, unsupported. Because as soon as you row away from the island, you lose sight of the other boats and you don't see a single soul until you get into Antigua. Now, there are a couple of yachts that shepherd the fleet, but as it spreads out, they are literally hundreds of miles apart and essentially can offer no help unless you get into really, really difficult situations, which luckily we didn't too often. So it really is an unsupported, isolated row. And I think what really struck us in terms of the distance was if you looked at that dot that Antigua's pointing to, if you went to the very right-hand edge of that dot, when we were there, our family hadn't even started the journey from North Yorkshire to Gatwick to get on the plane to fly out to see us finish. That's how, for me, that really puts the scale of the challenge of rowing 3,000 miles into perspective. We thought it would take 40 days. We actually did it in 37. And the record that Kian needed to break was 39 and a half days. And that would make him the fastest teenager and also the youngest, fastest member of a four-person crew. So he ended up with two world records, which we were delighted about. It was a phenomenal achievement for him and for us. But an organisation and an event, an expedition, doesn't come about without a lot of planning and preparation. We spent the best part of 18 months getting ready for this challenge. And it was anything and everything. It was the technical training, understanding how to row properly on an erg in a gym. It was the courses, the sea survival, the radio, the navigation. We spent a little bit of time at sea sailing to get used to the sort of marine environment. And lots of other, I suppose, stuff around the edges that we thought would be useful. Personality profiling to understand how we worked as a team. Through to the more extreme stuff that we thought we'd build a little bit of mental resilience. So rock climbing, abseiling, skydiving, pushing ourselves out of our comfort zone to build up a bit of, I suppose, courageous capital that we thought when the situations got tough at sea that they might help us and might toughen us up a little bit, help us cope better as a team. The actual technical in-boat training was mostly done off the coast of Hartlepool. Difficult to simulate the North Atlantic Ocean at the 1500 mile point when you're about 2 miles off the Hartlepool beach, but it was about all we had really to train with. And this sort of video gives you a rough indication of what it's like in terms of choppiness and the boat and the instability, which was great, and we learned a lot about the boat. But the one thing that it doesn't replicate, obviously, is the pure size, the scale of the sea, the waves tugging at the oars, and what it's going to do to that boat in different situations. What it did do, though, was give us a flavour for what seasickness was going to feel like. Now, you appreciate that looks a pretty calm sea, actually, and I suppose it was, but that was enough to tip young Kian over the edge into his first bout of seasickness. And he went rapidly downhill from that photo to the point where he was laying, I shouldn't laugh, but it, you know, it makes us laugh now looking back. He was laying on the deck of the boat, banging his head, banging the hull. He wanted to get off. He wanted to get in the water, swim to shore. He tried everything to escape. And it was a bit of a shock, I think, understanding how difficult seasickness was going to be and what it was going to do to us. And I think I also must say, in the preparation stage, we were, as you can see, Kian wearing his hoodie there. We were quite excited about what we were going to do, and we talked to anyone and everyone. And I do remember when we went to Gosport for a training event, we were sat in the cookhouse at Gosport, and one of the staff came over to us and said, what are you guys here for? So we're all there in our t-shirts and hoodies feeling, well, we're around the Atlantic, we're like celebrities. And so I leaned back at my chair and said, we're rowing the Atlantic later on this year. And she went, so does that mean you're going to be in for lunch then? Because I'm just trying to collate numbers. it was a real come down and a reminder to us that, well, we thought it was pretty special, that some people just didn't quite get it. So we were a little bit more careful with what we said to people after that point. But we still talk about that now. So the first lesson that I'm going to just mention, there's a couple of leadership lessons that I'm going to talk about. And I think this is one for people that struggle with failure, that worry about getting things wrong, whether it's anything from exam stress to a scout's test or badge that you've got coming up. It's this thing about failing fast. So in the army, we like to plan in detail and not really get anything wrong. But we couldn't afford to do that with our rowing campaign because none of us really knew what we were doing. So we threw a lot of that strategy out the window and just dived into trying everything. If we tried it and we could do it, we didn't really try it again because that was a done deal. If it failed or broke or we got it wrong, we'd go out and practice until we could get it right. And I think it's a really good mantra to sort of take away that failure is a great teacher, for one. Failure also contributes to the story of success that inevitably will come further down the line. And we decided that every failure was just going to be another little story and an anecdote, a tale to tell that makes a success that much sweeter later on. And as I say, I think that's just a mantra, and it's a mindset that's applicable to anything that you do. So in some ways, embrace failure because it is the best lesson that you will ever have. And I must say, we failed a lot. We broke things. I fell in. We banged the boat. And we were always trying to do things we couldn't do while people were watching. And it was a very uncomfortable place to be. But fail fast. Right, I'm hoping Chris is on the line now, because I'm going to pause and see whether he's going to jump in and take over. Chris, are you there?
I am. Can you see me?
Brilliant.
Yay.
I can, okay. Yeah. Go for it.
Awesome. Well, it's really good to be here. I'm going to talk really now about the start for when we got to La Gomera, what it was like, and then a little bit further about actually what it was like as soon as we went to sea. So we arrived in La Gomera on the 1st of December, and we had 11 days until the start, and that was our first look at the Atlantic Ocean. Rich and I had been out to have a look at the start the year before, so we weren't what we call going in blind. So we kind of knew what to expect, but when you're a competitor, everything changed. The first, I would say, 9 days was very benign. It was a party atmosphere. We were getting to know the other teams. Everyone was really excited. Everyone's running around trying to pass the inspections that we had to complete in the boatyard before the boats could even get put in the water. So it was really exciting. There was lots of party nights, although we tried to tame them as much as we could. And there were long, long days getting all the equipment laid out. And there's a lot of equipment we have to get on a very small boat to pass the inspection to get it into the water. And so that was kind of the first week or so. We got the boat in the water with about 2 or 3 days to spare until the race start. We went out, we tried our water maker, which I'll describe later on. It turned seawater into drinking water. We just had a little paddle around, got a feel for the boat again. And then the day before the start, we had a weather brief. And the brief was that there was a huge storm we were going out into that night. We looked on the map, you could see big areas of wind being funneled through the islands that we were on and out to sea as big red blobs on the map. And that was where, as we were told, there were going to be 30 to 40 knot winds with potentially 30 to 40 foot waves on our first night. Everyone went a bit quiet at that stage, as you can imagine. But we're army, you know, we've done tough stuff. We didn't mind. And I think we just kind of put it to the back of our minds that that's not going to happen to us. Every other team, but it's not going to be us. Well, we weren't quite right on that score, to be fair. The start day itself was absolutely fantastic. All the families were there. Lucy's daughter was playing the bagpipes as we went over the start line. There were flags flying, crowds cheering. And we set off in 10 to 20 minute intervals with the other teams. And we set off around about midday. And at this time, it was really quite calm. There was nothing to worry about. Again, this storm that was predicted was, you know, that's not going to happen. That won't happen to us. And as we rowed further away and the island of La Gomera became smaller and smaller in the distance and the nighttime drew upon us, it was like the Atlantic decided that it wasn't going to let us cross without causing us a fuss. These gigantic waves just suddenly appeared out of nowhere. And with that, we lost vision. We lost the light. We were into our first night. And it was truly terrifying. So that moment, that us thinking that it won't happen to us, helped us initially, but it was an incredibly scary first night with the boat up on its side, wave crashing down over us as we're just looking into the chasm of this next wave. And it kind of went on like that. And the first week was very much a bit of a shock and awe, a bit of us experiencing just what the Atlantic is all about, and nothing that we could have replicated in any of our training, as Rich just said. You're naturally going to suffer from seasickness. We all did at some stage, but none of us got it quite as ferocious as Kian got it in that training week. Thankfully, our hands just started to fall apart. The waves continued to just batter us. And we had to get used to nighttime rowing where you cannot see a thing until the moon comes up. So the only way you could tell if a wave was about to crash on you was feeling the boat moving up. And then you'd see this white horse, this break of a wave, and you just hold on tight. We had to get used to the food, and we'll talk more about the food later. But it was just eating out the dry food that we put the water into and trying to eat as much as we could before we went to sleep. Was trying to get used to drinking as much as we could. And then it was 2 hours on, 2 hours off routine that was such a horrendous routine to try and get used to. Mix all that in with just a feeling of utter helplessness because we didn't see another boat in that first week. And actually, we didn't see many boats at all through the whole crossing. So it was a real shocker of a first week that took a lot of getting used to, even though we knew it would. What we've got now is a little clip of a friend of ours called Gabby, who is a solo rower. And when I talk about the big waves, this is the sort of wave that she encountered. And actually, this was a capsize of a solo rowing boat. So as you can see, that's pretty scary, and that to happen at night as well, you know, as it did. Over to you, Rich. What have we got next?
Right, we've got three little video clips that I suppose summarise the three different parts of the row. But they'll be a little bit jerky, but they've got subtitles on, a little bit of music. So sit back and enjoy, and hopefully it brings to life some of what it's like out there for real.
This is our first video from La Gomera. We made it.
How you feeling then?
Alright?
Confident, yeah. Well, just want to go on.
How you liking a new stash?
It's better than our stash, to be honest. That's
what?
Not enough, isn't it?
What do you mean?
Hearty shot.
Third day of the Talisker Whiskey Atlantic Challenge 2019. I've really done my filmmaker's boy, it has been rough. The crew, I think we've all been sick. Still suffering a bit of seasickness, no appetite whatsoever. Since we start, well, I can't think about it. I don't know. No other option, just to keep going.
We've all been seasick, not just me for once.
We GoPro at the bottom of the boat yesterday, and there's like a little ecosystem under there, so we're going to get our bathing costumes on, and
we are cleaning the bottom of the boat. It's not the best of conditions to clean the boat in, but it'll do.
So one of the things I just want to talk about on the back of that video, and I mentioned it at the start, was about that we undertook some of these crazy activities to build mental resilience and what we thought would give us a bit of an edge when we were out at sea. And I think, in you know, when I get back now and look at what we did and how the Army approaches mental resilience, in some ways we got it wrong. I put this picture up. This is what the Army currently considers its, I suppose, pillars of mental resilience. And when you look at it, they all, for me, distill into subjects related to control, to positivity, to belief, and to trust. Now, none of those really reflect on jumping out of aircraft or putting yourself in difficult, stressful, physical slash dangerous situations. They actually relate more to teamwork than they do to adventurous training. So I think, you know, when we when we look at what we needed as a team, what made us get up each day after an hour's sleep? What made us row in the pitch black with waves crashing around us? Not what made us not give up? What made us keep going through the aches and pains and the blisters and the sores? It wasn't because we'd been rock climbing and we'd had a stressful situation imposed upon us. It was actually because we believed in the team and we believed in each other. And we had loyalty, that we trusted each other, that we wanted to work for each other, and what our teammates thought of us mattered. So that to me is a really, really good antidote to a stressful situation. And I think, again, that implies in every single situation, in every walk of life. So you don't need mental resilience. It's not just the preserve of those that go and do dangerous things. It's the preserve of anyone that wants to be a successful team member, that wants to run a successful team, for the scouts, for the cubs, for the brownies, for the guides, any sort of organized group of people that have a common goal and a common purpose need mental resilience, but it's founded on great teamwork. And I think if we did more of the stuff that bound us together as a team, rather than the difficult activity per se, I think we'd have actually got even further down that road. We're a pretty strong team anyway, but I think for me, on reflection, that's one of the areas that we would have changed in terms of our training and preparation. Chris.
Hello. So we're going to talk about once the initial 7 days were over, everything came down to routine. Everything came down to just doing the same thing again and again and getting it right, or trying to get it as right as that was. Things such as making the water. So we had to make the water at the same time every day, when the sun was at its highest, when it had the most power going through the solar panels, in order to run the water maker machine. It was making sure that we eat, making sure that when we come off of that shift and you do your 2 hours on and you have 2 hours off, you don't sleep for those 2 hours. You have to spend 20 minutes of that either doing jobs around the boat, feeding yourself, perhaps getting some food ready for someone else, making sure you take on fluids, and of course go to the toilet. And there were the toilet facilities, it was literally, in the worst case scenario, a bucket, and that meant clambering over people and going in front of people. It was very rudimentary. So ultimately you got about an hour's 40 sleep at a time, and with that, and that constant routine, that constant 2 hours on, 2 hours off, the sore hands, your feet fall into pieces, all those horrendous things. With that came some fantastic moments as well. The wildlife we saw. In the first, I believe it was the first week, we had a pod of dolphins visit us and doing flips out of the water. We had a shark follow us. We had sailfish. We had flying fish that launched themselves at the boat, targeting the boat deliberately, I'm sure, just to kill themselves. And if they can't hit you, if they miss the boat and carry on, they carry on for another 200 or so meters, and they are absolutely lethal. We'd see bits of rubbish, but not as much as we thought, floating along. And it might be a container that's fallen off of a fishing vessel. And it was something that wasn't blue or white like the clouds. It might be something red, and we'd see it bobbing past, and someone would mention it, and we'd all dive out of our cabins, and we'd look at this thing just bobbing past until it went out of view, and then a little bit of us died because we'd lost that colour in our lives again. With that constant routine came a mental game, and it was a mental game with yourself. Rich has already said about, you're not going to let the team down. You will get up on time and you will get out of that hatch. But your concept of time was horrendous. You would wake up, and it's called Atlantic maths. You'd wake up in the middle of the night because your alarm has gone off, and you know you've set your alarm with 20 minutes to go before you have to be out on deck. But you'll be looking at your watch and it might say 12:40 midnight, so 20 to 1 in the morning. And you know you've got to be on the deck at 1 in the morning. But you can't work it out in your head, and you'll stare at your watch for maybe 10 minutes trying to figure out, what does 12:40 mean? And sometimes you'd get it wrong, and sometimes you'd go out on deck an hour early, and that happened quite a lot. I I hallucinated. I saw someone run past the boat at about 3 a.m. one day. And I didn't think anything of it. My only thought was, it's a bit too early to go for a run. So there's all these amazing things, amazing sights, incredible sunsets, sunrises, horrendously scary nights, flat, calm waters, constant routine, constant pain, but tied in with that, some amazing, amazing laughs. Christmas Day was 15 minutes long. We were rowing and you just rowing, and because we kept the same time as the UK, even though we'd moved through to so many different time zones, we knew that it was midday or 1 o'clock in the afternoon on Christmas Day back in the UK. And it may have been 9 a.m. for us, really, but everyone's having their dinner and we were rowing. And so we thought, oh, we've got some presents. So we stopped, opened our presents for 15 minutes, decided that we were just needlessly bobbing around and just carried on rowing. And such is life. And it all became a blur. Everything just, I'm sure if you asked Rich or I now, what were we doing on the 20th of December? We wouldn't have a clue. What were we doing on the 4th, 5th of January? I couldn't tell you. We were rowing somewhere in an ocean and it all looked the same. So that's kind of getting yourself through that, just that mental battle, that continuance of the same thing, but tied in with that, just not letting each other down. And that was us through the main element of it. Some awesome times and some horrendous times.
One of my funniest moments. It's such a simple thing, but Chris developed a reputation for clumsiness quite early on. I think it started when the GoPro camera got knocked over the side, followed by some insoles from a trainer, followed by a shirt, one of our UV shirts, and then the towers that boiled the water for the food got knocked over. Stuff just went missing. There's a lot of pollution and debris trailing the boat over 3,000 miles of the Atlantic. Well, my funniest moment was going to the toilet on the boat was pretty tricky. It was a bucket and it's a very unstable platform. You have to hold on. Your leg strength has been gradually worn away over the trip. So Chris was wrestling with going to the toilet on a particularly choppy day. And he's got a pack of wet wipes in his hand. The wet wipes were the toilet paper. They're biodegradable, a bit friendlier to the ocean. So he's holding on with one hand. And the wet wipe, they sort of stick out in tufts. And you grab a little wet wipe and tease it out one at a time. So he's holding on with one hand and he's got the wet wipes in his mouth and he's trying to get the tuft out and it's jammed and it's gone into this ball. There's like 20 of them all wanting to come out in one go, but they're so precious. He's teasing and teasing. So he gets to the point where he loses his temper with this one wet wipe that won't come out and he shakes it really hard and the whole pack flies overboard apart from the one wet wipe that he manages to keep hold of, which then clearly isn't enough to do what he needs it to do. So we then have to go and get him some more. But I think it's that dilemma, that frustration of the simplest little things in life that on a boat are magnified, combined with a bit of clumsiness. And it's just a funny little moment. Anyway.
I think one worth saying about as well is when you think you've got everything, and it's a good sort of analogy for life. But when you think you're used to everything, when you think that you've got this nailed, there's always something else there to catch you out. And that with us, that was quite often it was a freak wave, which on three occasions almost capsized our boat. And the scariest thing I've ever done in my life, the scariest moment of my life. And as Rich said, I've been on lots and lots of tours. You know, I'm that old that one of my first campaigns was as a knight of the realm in chainmail. And another one was cleaning the boat, a simple task, jumping in and cleaning the boat. We're 1,000 miles plus out. And it's about that in feet, way more than that down. And it's all camaraderie and bravado until you have to jump in the water. And when you do, it's my God, am I going to look, do I look down? Do I dare look down? I'm just going to get in and clean the boat. So we're really, really noisy and gobby until we jumped over the side. And it's probably just as well we couldn't talk to each other anyway. It's just that sort of fearful look in our eyes as we rapidly clean the boat and then just tried to jump up over the side. And then the other one was lightning strikes at night, lightning and thunder at night, because we're the most exposed thing on the ocean. And when you see lightning strikes start to hit the water, well, it's only a matter of time before they get potentially to hit us. Luckily, that didn't happen. But yeah, when you think you've got everything nailed, there's always something to catch you out.
Right, video part two.
My weakness, I feel I must finally show. Body.
On shark watch, we're having a shark treading the boat about 2 meters long, just making out the shadow of the water. The other side, the kids, tiny flat backsides. Oh! So, as expected, the hammerhead returned back to us. We always knew it was going to happen. Richard's floundering on the oars was going to attract predators one way or another. And yeah, the hammerhead came back, swung around for a bit. We tried to bait it with biltong. So, our next step is we're going to lather Kian up with peanut butter, have a clench of pepperoni between his cheeks, and see if he'll take that. Check back in a bit.
So in terms of tracking the boat, you know, the communications kit we had and how we knew where we were and how our friends and family could watch us, the boat was pretty well equipped. We had what's called a chart plotter, so a sort of display screen that showed the Atlantic Ocean as a map. It showed the route and it gave us a good sense of confidence that we were rowing in the right direction, which was really important. And we also had a UK-based assistant that would give us the bearings to row on. She tracked the weather, she tracked where the other boats were, and she really was sort of a combination between a weather advisor and a race router to help us get into the, I suppose, the best position and make the crossing as efficient as possible. The boat itself was equipped with a GPS tracker that was linked back to an app that everyone had on their smartphone called YB Races, so all the friends and family could see how the race was progressing and zoom in on their favourite boat and see, you know, what they'd done that day and how far they had to go. And this little clip here is about, I think it's about 4 days worth of rowing. Force Atlantic's that one highlighted with the white line around it. And at this point here, we'd actually got into fourth place. So the 35 teams, we had quite a slow start because of a couple of technical difficulties, but we got up into fourth place, which for us is a really, really dangerous place to be, which I'll explain in a moment. But our chief rivals just above us were the Royal Navy, also entering for the first time. And on that particular day, we'd snuck in front of them. So I think had we not decided as a team what the priorities of this expedition were, there's a danger that we could have got a little bit carried away, I think, with getting into third place and actually changed what we were doing. Risk perhaps by rowing harder, getting injured, perhaps taking more risk than we needed to, but ultimately I suppose losing sight of what we were there to do, which was be a professional team and finish the race and get Kian a record. So to sort of highlight that a little bit more, a complicated campaign like this involved lots of different potentially competing demands. At the strategic level, we wanted to be professional, we wanted not to fail, and we wanted to make sure that by being successful that we were supporting the recruiting effort of the British Army, that we were making a statement, as I said earlier, about the quality of young people, about the opportunity that the Army provides as an employer that thinks it's normal to go and row the Atlantic, even as your most newly joined member of the team. At the team level, we wanted to break the world record, as we mentioned. We wanted to beat the Navy and the statement that would make about almost beating them at their own game, but obviously playing on that that friendly rivalry that we have with our other services, and also get exposure for our sponsors, because the whole campaign was actually paid for by corporate sponsorship. So it wasn't an army funded event, and we were only permitted to do it if we were able to raise the money to obviously make it a cost zero event for a taxpayer. So we wanted to pay back our sponsors, get them exposure, and make them feel really that they were part of this journey. And at the individual level, it's anything and everything from, you know, why do you climb a mountain? Why do you row an ocean? Well, because they're there. We all have desires to compete and perform and push ourselves and do well. And we genuinely saw it as the adventure of a lifetime, perhaps the only chance that we would get to do anything like this, given the cost and the time and the dedication that had to go into getting us to the start line. And we were all pretty keen on raising money for charity. We were doing this for the Army Benevolent Fund. So, you know, it's a charity close to our heart, and we wanted to raise as much money as we could. And again, we were torn between sort of charity fundraising events or technical training to make us more efficient. So all those things were potentially competing and pulling against each other. But we decided that top one, that being professional and not failing, was the most important thing. And we had a conversation when we were in fourth place about what we were going to do. You know, were we going to row hard because we knew the Navy would be coming back at us? Or were we going to just keep doing what we knew would be successful and would get us to the end? And actually, because we'd already decided that before we set off, it was quite a simple conversation that we weren't going to change the shift pattern. We weren't going to push ourselves any harder than we were already pushing. And if that meant slipping back down the field, which is what eventually happened, then so be it, because we were already winning and achieving everything that we wanted to achieve. So, you know, it's a difficult conversation in some ways, but I'm very proud and very glad that we did it. And I'm very glad that we finished professionally and didn't fail is the most important thing. And Chris, I'll leave it to Chris to sort of summarize the final what it's like to actually row into Antigua and that joyous moment.
Thanks. Just getting my dog out of the room. Go. the finish was the most amazing time, I think, of all of our lives. And Rich and I are both fathers, and, you know, married. And you have to say, it's at the time we felt it surpassed even that. We were rowing along. We knew we had days to go. We weren't quite sure what day we were going to come in, and that was balanced against when our loved ones were arriving in Antigua. So there was a bit more urgency to try and get in. And it was, I think, the last week, just as you can imagine, when you want something so badly, everything starts to slow down. And that last week, it was like it was going backwards. It took so long. Every shift felt like you were doing a 4-hour shift, and it felt like you were sleeping even shorter. And any injuries that we had, certainly that I had, whilst my mind had taken over that there's bigger dangers out there, and therefore you no longer have a bad back, my mind said, right, you're almost finished, your back's going to start hurting again. And it did. On the second from last night, when we thought we were in the clear of the Atlantic, we thought the Atlantic had finally let us get across it and it had given up. The second from last night, an absolutely huge storm hit us. And there's always a funny thing to come out of everything, I think, in life, but certainly in the Army. And we're a little bit of black humour always helps to see the funny side. And prior to this, Rich had his cabin, the inside of his cabin, soaked through on two other occasions. And that is not easy when you are trying to get in your cabin and sleep every 2 hours, or there's always someone in there anyway. And all of a sudden, the only soft thing you have to sleep on is soaked through along with all your other kit. And that can be so easy done by a freak wave, by the hatch being open just slightly. And Rich was at the end of his tether with this. He thought he'd dried his kit out for the very last time. That night, he battened his hatches down. He made sure everything was watertight. Kian and I were rowing. It was about 2 a.m. and a huge wave picked us up. And you could just feel the boat starting to tip over the wave. So I put a big oar stroke in.
And normally we would just glide down the wave quite nicely, pick up maybe 10 knots. This time it was one of the enormous waves that were out there. It picked us up and it sent us vertically down this wave. The front dug in, a huge sheet of wave came over my head from the front of the boat, and the wave itself crashed over the back of the boat. An enormous amount of water went into Richard's cabin, which was at the stern, at the back of the boat, effectively. And Richard was woken up by this shower, effectively, coming from the bottom of the boat where he was sleeping, straight up all over him. He woke up, couldn't quite figure out what was going on, ignored the fact that Kian and I were screaming on the deck because we thought we were about to die. When we finally came out of it, opened the hatch, effing and blinding that his kit was soaked again. So there's a really good leadership model that, you know, look after yourself before anyone else. Don't look after yourself for anyone else. I'm only joking. But that was the last week. Still, the Atlantic was throwing everything it could at us. And then we were rowing along and Alex stood up and said, "Oh my God, I can see something." We all stood up and it was like a shipwreck film. Suddenly, there's land. And we saw this tiny, tiny island in the distance. And we're still maybe 2 days away at this stage. But it was the most incredible experience. And everything from there just got better and better. And then it was nighttime when we arrived just off of Antigua. We were met by the Coast Guard. So there was a blue light flashing. It was something different that we hadn't seen in 37 days. It was another voice talking to us that we hadn't heard. And it was just incredible. They guided us in and we rowed alongside them to the harbour. Captain Cook's harbour, Rich, what was it?
Nelson's harbour.
Nelson's harbour. And as we came there, the boats caught up with us, the media boats, the noise, the sound, everyone cheering. We let our flares off, as you can see in the picture, and you'll see later. And we just came in to all of our friends, all of our families in the dock. Just the most amazing, amazing experience and an incredible finish to the whole thing.
And we've got a little clip of that coming up.
Oh my God. These are our little messages from home, little words of inspiration.
This has just smacked itself into the boat.
Timeline fishing.
Different type of palm flat day today.
This is our view. Still as
anything. It's just us, the sea, and our own company.
Still rowing.
They're throwing me overboard.
Final week. A special moment on the trip now, the thing that we've dreamed about and waiting for what seems like a lifetime. Because in the distance, what have we got? I think we've got the Coast Guard coming up on the rib. Oh, excited.
Now I'm a mile away. And I'll get yours too. pieces and all the to the finish line. So come back for your lifetime. I walk a mile in your shoes.
So there you go. Wasn't it, as Chris said, an amazingly emotional and fitting end to, yeah, almost 18 months, I think, of hard work, of sacrifice, of doubt, a little bit of criticism, I suppose, from some quarters. But, you know, like anything in life, and I think the iceberg picture just summarizes it, anything in life that's worth doing, that is worth shouting about, is always underpinned by huge amounts of preparation and work commitment, and this was no different to any of those sorts of projects. And again, you know, like anything in life, there are lessons, there are parallels that can be drawn, anything from the importance of a routine in something like lockdown through to, you know, being prepared to fail as you get better and improve at something and embrace that as a teacher. So it was an experience, it was an adventure, it was a life lesson, it was a campaign, it was part of our lives for 18 months. And honestly, that finish, that point where we could see Antigua, those last few days were just an incredible, for us, reward for everything that we'd, I think, done for the army, done for charity, and done for people that I suppose had followed the journey a little bit, and hopefully been inspired by what we're trying to achieve. And just on that, in terms of the inspiring bit, we've done a lot of presentations to schools, and it was part of our campaign to talk to young people about what we're doing and hopefully get them to set their sights high on their own personal goals and adventures. And we picked up Mini Force Atlantic on the way, which is from my little boy Charlie from his school. His mates got really into it, and they're trying to record a video to wish us good luck for a night that we had. But I put this together because I think it just encapsulates for us the fact that we did spark some ideas and some thoughts to some of the young people that we spoke to. So this is Mini Force Atlantic.
Hi Dad. And in 2027 we're gonna row the Atlantic. You have the
Hashtag Mini Force Atlantic.
Rich, you have inspired us with the grit.
You're a great role model and
have a good night.
Hi Dad. You know who we are, but for those who don't, I'm Charlie.
Daniel, shut up!
Hi Dad. You know who we are, but for those who don't, I'm Charlie.
I'm Freddie.
I'm Daniel.
And I'm Oscar.
Hashtag Mini Force Atlantic.
Rich, you have inspired us with the great work you have accomplished.
And in 2027, we're going to row the Atlantic.
We know it will be hard, but we are ready for anything with your inspirational quotes, such as, dream big and you'll get there.
You're a great role model and have a good night.
Bye!
Mini Force Atlantic. The other thing I wanted to mention was that we did invest a lot in the charitable fundraising. And then linked to the college, the Army Foundation College, he was Captain Colonel Sir Tom Moore, became appointed as our honorary colonel. So I got invited on to Good Morning Britain just to be the Army representative and talk about what it meant to have Captain Tom, you know, given that honour and us to receive his honour. But I think someone had done the research for Piers Morgan because he chose to have a little bit of a dig about our charity fundraising in comparison. Let me play you this.
You rode the Atlantic at the end of last year with three others in very cramped conditions, very hazardous conditions. And apparently your friends are mocking you because you only managed to raise £40,000 in 40 days, whereas Captain Tom, walking around his garden, has raised nearly £30 million in 3 weeks.
Yeah, my Just Giving page pales into insignificance.
Yeah, nothing like being made fun of on national TV, is there? But I'm glad he mentioned the row anyway. But that's it. That's our reflections on Around the Atlantic. I hope you found it interesting. I hope it's inspired some of you to take on your own personal challenges. And the fact that, you know, we are just ordinary people that got involved in an extraordinary campaign. But there's no reason why anyone of any shape, size, age or experience can't do similar sorts of things. And we are living proof that it can be done. So thanks very much.
So we've got time for a couple of questions. So from George and from Alex, they've both asked about food. What type of food did you eat, and what did you have to eat? I will send that to Chris. We've not heard from Chris for a while. So Chris, what, tell us about the food, please.
Yes, sure. The food was effectively packs, dried packs of food. And we had snack packs, so plastic bags full of all the sorts of things that we might like to eat to supplement that. So we took all of our food with us for the whole crossing. At no stage did we get given any extra food or any extra water. We were completely self-sufficient from the moment we paddled away. And it was a bit of a gamble, really, because we had these four hatches, big, deep hatches, that we put all of the food into. And it was quite often a bit of a gamble as to what you got for breakfast and how often you're going to dip your hand in to pull something out. How long are you going to do that before you settle for a chicken tikka for breakfast instead of a muesli? And all we did, we boiled the water that we made from the sea in what's called jet boils, poured it in to these sachets of dried food, let them become effectively normal food, and ate them. And they were really high in calories, and so it's very hard for a normal person to eat them all in one go. Rich would often eat two in one go quite easily, and we supplemented them, like I say, with these snack packs that really should have been all the best stuff, high calories type stuff that we wanted to eat, but turned out to be jelly beans and peanuts mashed together in the bottom. The dog's going mad. In the bottom of in a plastic bag. So there you go. That was our food.
Rich, Chris, can I just pick up a couple of questions that have been asked there? You jumped in the water and cleaned the bottom of the boat. How cold was the water and why did you need to clean the water? Interesting questions, those.
Yeah, so we knew we were going to have to clean the boat. The advice was that about every 5 to 7 days, if you look at the bottom of it, there'll be stuff growing on there, which I almost didn't believe. I thought, well, you know, how quickly could it attach to a moving rowing boat that had this anti-foul special paint coated on it as well? But sure enough, you know, we dipped the GoPro in the water. I played the video back on my phone, had a look, and there's quite a lot on there. So you have to scrape it off just to reduce the drag. And it gives you, you can actually feel it. When the boat's clean, you can feel the difference in speed. So it was done for efficiency reasons. And in terms of the water was warm and got warmer as we got to Antigua. And it always surprised me when a wave came over and hit you, that it was warm water. It wasn't a particularly unpleasant experience. And then when we jumped in, it was like jumping into a lukewarm bath. So not too bad at all. But actually, I think the scarier, sort of more challenging thing was it was never really calm when we cleaned the boat. It was always rougher than we wanted it to be. And the boat would be moving up and down. And there's a danger that it would come down on your head if you weren't careful. So you had to really pick your moments where you'd get right underneath it and do a bit of a scrape and then come back out the way. So you sort of got used to anticipating what the boat and the water was doing. We were at our most vulnerable when we weren't on the boat. One of the main safety things, or the overriding safety principle, was that we had a harness and we were attached to the boat at all times. And even on, it was one of the pictures on there, where I'd swam away from the boat as far as I dare, I was still tied on to the boat with a line. I just wanted to get a wide angle picture of the boat in the Atlantic. But so the water was warm. We needed to keep the boat clean for speed reasons. But it was an exhilarating / slightly terrifying experience doing that as well.
Okay, okay. We've had another question here. Someone asked about where you stored your food. So I'll ask it more generally. What did you, how much storage space did you have on the boat? How much could you store?
There was a huge amount of storage space on the boat, actually, if you put the various bits of equipment in the right place. Even inside the cabins, there were hatches underneath the floor.
or in the very, very nose of the boat. We didn't have, I personally, I don't know if you'd agree with this, I thought we would be a lot more pushed for space than perhaps we were when we started planning. The food, when we piled it all on the boat in the boxes before we packed the boat, we were just looking at it thinking, oh my God, where are we gonna put all this? And we did just about manage to get it into the four hatches on the deck, because they open up into quite large compartments either side. So it was all okay. If we were to do it again, we didn't need the parachute anchor, thankfully, which keeps the boat from being dragged backwards too far in the wind against where you want to go. We very, very almost used it, but I managed to talk Rich out of it long enough for us not to need it in the end. But if we were to do it again, I would have stored that somewhere different, because that was in one of the compartments, and that would have been really, really hard work just to get out and set up. But all in all, I think the storage, it wasn't too bad. Perhaps a little bit harder for Rich's cabin, because he had a slightly smaller cabin. I was in the 4-star compared to his, you know, 1-star in Blackpool somewhere, bed and breakfast.
Yeah, people ask a lot about the cabins. Mine was a bit smaller, but the feet went underneath the rowing station out on decks. I mean, the boat is essentially hollow. I'm 6'2" and I could lay down easily, like fully in the boat. The hardest thing for me was the constant rocking of the boat just rolled you around and you were trying to sleep. So luckily we'd had some advice to take sleep bean bags with us. So we had a couple of child's bean bags, and by positioning it almost like a sort of maternity cushion, you could cuddle it and wedge yourself into one spot. And for me, that was absolutely perfect. I got a decent amount of sleep just through that little technique. But I think Chris is right. You know, the boat has a lot of storage space in it, and we didn't pack particularly efficiently because it was the first time we'd done it. But yeah, they are amazingly capable boats and deceptively big.
You talked there about the sleep and how you got to sleep, and you mentioned earlier about the 2-hour stints that you were doing. Somebody's asked how much sleep you actually were allowed to have. So in a 24-hour period, about how much sleep did you get? Because I'm guessing you probably couldn't sleep at every 2 hours that you had, where there was some time off. I'm guessing you couldn't sleep at all of them.
Yeah, so I think I worked it out that in the night shift, so half the crossing was at night, so 12 hours of darkness, 12 hours of daylight. In the roughly the 3 shifts I did at night, I would grab about an hour's sleep in each of the off shifts. So 3 hours sleep in the darkness, and then I was averaging about 1 hour's sleep in the daytime shifts, partly because it was quite hot to sleep in the day. You do most of your jobs in the day. And you tend to eat a bit more in the day than you do at night as well, so it takes time to prepare all the food. So I think I was averaging about 4 hours in every 24-hour period, which isn't bad, but the hours when you're awake, obviously you're physically working quite hard, so you probably need a little bit more than that, which is why, as Chris mentioned about the Atlantic maths, the mental capacity for problem solving slowly decreases over time, I think, as you start to degrade and suffer with sleep loss.
Yeah, I suppose I would agree with that as well. I think I got slightly more sleep than Rich did. He's doing himself a disservice there, because actually, as the skipper, Rich did a lot of work on the calculations, on the communications, etc., that we didn't have to worry about. And as a benefit of that, I think I was probably managing on average 5.5, perhaps even 6 hours sleep a day. And even though that's broken up, that really did make quite a difference when you get used to it. Sometimes it would feel that if I managed to sleep for an hour and 15, I would wake up after 20 minutes and feel that I've overslept and not really need any more sleep. So yeah, very, very strange.
Okay, so we've got two more questions and then we're going to end it there. So one of them is from Six Bridgerton, who asked, what did you get for Christmas? And the second one was, what did it feel like when it stepped out onto land? Did it feel odd that you're actually on solid land again?
Go on, I'll let Chris do the land one, because...
Yeah, oh, don't want to do it now, sorry, okay. So when we stepped out on land, I had a real problem with all the training, just being on the boat or even on the jetty for a little while, that I would come off and for hours and hours afterwards, I would feel the whole room moving. So I was dreading getting off the boat because I thought I was going to be like that for weeks. But actually, when I stepped off the boat, I just, in fact, we all did, but I think perhaps me more so initially, you try to go forward and you just fall to the left. We hadn't stood up straight for 37 days, really. And so all of our postural muscles that would keep us up straight normally, well, none of them were working properly. And with that and our heads still spinning from being on the boat, if you notice, I probably wouldn't see it, but the video at the end when they're talking to us and when we're getting off the boat, we had to hold on to things because you just could not stand up straight. And I couldn't stand up straight for about a week afterwards.
Yeah, it was a bizarre feeling. We thought we'd get land sick, but it wasn't the sickness. It was just, yeah, I think as Chris said, that not having the muscles firing that normally fire to hold you up is like being reborn. Almost just wobbling around like toddlers. For Christmas, our family were brilliant. They gave us Christmas presents that we took on board, stashed right at the bottom of the cabins out of the way, and then brought them out on Christmas Day. And actually, most of what we got was chocolate, which was amazing. And it became like illegal currency on the boat. You could trade for anything and everything from someone making you breakfast through to an extra half an hour on the oars. Well, actually, Chris, you got some stuff from your mum and dad, didn't you? You got some of the Hames traditional Christmas Day presents.
Yeah, an orange and some hazelnuts. Now we all got a little bag from my mum and dad, which was great, and we opened it, and there were chocolates and things in. But the one key thing that we did not have, and maybe not a bad thing on reflection, none of us thought to bring any Christmas music. So whilst we had music that we could listen to every day, as long as it wasn't Kian's rubbish, then we didn't have Christmas music on Christmas Day. God knows what we listened to. I don't think we listened to anything, but it was a brief, the briefest Christmas Day I've ever had. And I've been overseas on tour at Christmas and had better Christmas days.
Well, thank you very much. And thank you to all of you for putting in your questions. We're going to leave it there now. So my final thanks go to Lieutenant Colonel Richard Hall, Captain Chris Hames and Lieutenant Colonel Donna Lodge, all from the British Army, for joining us this evening and for making this happen for us. Thank you all for tuning in. I wish you a good evening and good night.